Good afternoon, friends, and good afternoon, Mr. S. N. Murthy, a senior advocate from Karnataka High Court. As we all know that there is change in the labor laws by enacting of different codes, that is Industrial Relation Code, Code on Social Security. And once these are the changes, we thought that we should have some inner insights on the subject of these labor law changes. And therefore, we have started a three-part series. And the first part, it will be all on Wednesdays. And the first part starts today on Industrial Relations Code 2020. We are all thankful to Mr. S. N. Murthy, who has taken out time. We can understand that he's having quite busy schedule, that even right now he's in his court dress. And we are enamored by the fact that he has given us the time to understand. Industrial Relations Code 2020. Has brought in a lot of changes by bringing three basic acts, that is the Trade Union Act, Industrial Employment, a Standing Orders Act, and the Industrial Disputes Act, into what can be said in a consolidated manner. And there are major changes. From 100 workers, it goes to 300 workers. What is the effect of the standing orders? What is the term of fixed terms employment in respect of lockouts, strikes, etc.? And keeping in view the fact that during these testing times, what could be the challenges to the said act, and as to whether vis-a-vis those three acts, the Industrial Relation Code is in terms of the understanding whether it will help the employers, especially the private employers, and secondly, as to whether it is pro-employees. Like in the previous codes when we were there, being a social legislation, it was always thought, especially in terms of retrenchment, layoff, etc., that it was more tilted towards the favor of the employees, workers, and what are the new changes of fixed terms, employment, etc. Without taking much time, I would request Mr. S. N. Murthy to give his insights on this new code and part one of this series, which sir has agreed to share his knowledge upon.
Shall I start?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon, Mr. Vikas, and all those listening to me. It's been a great pleasure coming before you to address on this very, very vital subject, which would affect not only the working class, but the economy of the nation also. A great need was felt from a long time to bring some changes in labor laws. Now, an opportunity came across. I have a mixed feeling about this. While an attempt is made, and to a great extent, fairly, I would say correctly, to arrest the corruption in the entire system, labor laws is one of those den of corruption and which affected the industry very badly. 10 inspectors go, each inspector expects something. Every form you need to pay something. It is not in one state, but in every state. And this put a lot of pressure on the industry. Added to that, at every stage, threat of prosecution. You didn't file a form, I'll prosecute you. There's a small injury, I'll hold you negligent and prosecute you. Now, this kind of threat has been no good. In fact, I am quite surprised. The government has missed a golden opportunity to set right things. India is the only country in the world where you have a right to start a business, but no right to close the business. You can start an industry, but you are not allowed to close down the industry. What a shocking thing this is for anyone to hear. This has taken away the flexibility in employment completely. You employ 100 people or more, organize yourself. You can't lay off workmen when there's no work. You can't retrench workmen when there are surplus. You can't close when the business becomes non-viable. And you say, and you threaten him of sending to jail. What sort of law this has been? Unfortunately, for me, today, I feel sad when I see the amendments that have been brought out in Code 1. While I do not rule out some good things that have come, but the core thing is, the most important thing is, you talk of ease of doing business. What is that ease of doing business that you have achieved? The labor minister, union labor minister, at every function says, we are now relaxing law, ease of doing business, it will become very easy and things and so on and so forth. Now, what is the court done? Let me start with the Industrial Disputes Act, where in the Industrial Relations Code, this is found in the code number 1, the third enactment. Industry, for that matter, educational institution is industry, hospital is industry, Pinjarapol is an industry, a lawyer's office is an industry, chartered accountant's office is an industry. This is what Justice Krishna Iyer gave us. All right, in 1978, to some extent, okay, we can even say, oh, justiciable at that point of time. Today, we are there almost half a century later on, and we still have the same law. 18th August 1984, the Government of India, the Parliament, which had passed the bill to amend the definition of industry, was signed by the President. Then after, 3 to 4 different benches of the Supreme Court directed the government to give effect to it, but government did not do. And what has it done now when all these cases are pending in courts? They have brought another altogether different definition of industry, leaving all the problems as they are. There's hardly any change. Even today, school, even under the code, school will continue to be an industry, college will continue to be an industry, barber shop will continue to be an industry, a pinjara pole will be continue to be an industry, a members club will continue to be an industry. What is all this? Again, you have missed the bus. Then what is it that you do? What did you do? All that you have done is, only thing I can say, which may be of some importance, is with regard to the definition of wage has been amended. It has been made a little more clear for everyone to understand what is the definition of wage. Now, the only noticeable thing according to me is from 100 you took to 300. 100 was the threshold limit for less than 100 you can lay off, retrench or close depending upon the need without government permission. If you have 100 or more, you require to take government permission for layoff, retrenchment and closure. Now that threshold limit has been raised to 300. In other words, industrial establishments employing less than 300 workmen will now be able to lay off, retrench or workmen without going to the government once the code comes into force. This is not sufficient. Let us take auto industry today, for that matter. They are not able to sell half of what they were producing. They are not able to even, they have no orders to continue with manufacturing activity. They all employ thousands of people. What are they to do now? You don't give permission to lay off. You don't give permission to stay. You don't give permission to close. What do you expect these people to do then? That situation continues. Now take, for example, next one. With regard to strikes and lockout. Sorry, you'll have to excuse me because of my throat issue. Strikes and lockouts. Earlier, the present law is, there are two categories. One is public utility services. The other one is the private sector. public utility services, declared public utility services, had certain some sort of a protection. Today, they have incorporated such a miserable clause with regard to strikes and lockouts. Whether it is public sector, whether it is a public utility service, or whether it is a private sector, to give, to lock out, you need to give 14 days notice. If you do not give 14 days notice to lock out, you could be prosecuted. Courts will say pay wages. Lockout will be called illegal. Tell me one thing, if in a factory of 300 people or 500 people, if 50 workmen go on threatening inside, the officers, but don't go on strike. They threaten the officers. They ill-treat them. Production is normal. They don't go on strike. What is to be done? You have to bear with 14 days notice. Take the other extreme case. There is certain element of sabotage inside, but you are not able to identify. Production is normal. Workers are working, but there is sabotage. Difficult. Intellectual crookedness amongst some of the trade union leaders and workforce. You have now reached a stage where they don't work with heart and soul. At the same time, there is hardly anything you can do to lock out. Let's presume general manager is slapped on the shop floor in the presence of 500 workmen on the shop floor. What is that relief you have? What is that remedy you have? You can't lock out because you have to give 14 days notice. And this is something which is totally, which has never been contemplated by the or understood, or they have not even foreseen such situations while doing this. Bureaucrats must involve, make a good committee constituted of experts in the field from all over the country when they make such amendments. Not that a few bureaucrats sit in air-conditioned cabins in New Delhi and make and say, okay, 46 laws are made into 4 courts. Now, therefore, the amendment should always be positive, forward-looking. Now, what is that you can do if the workmen indulge in such activities, right, that they make it, that they force you to lock out, but they do not allow you to call their activity as strike? If they go on strike, no problem, you can lock out. In which case, question of 14 days notice does not arise. But trade unions leaders are not fools. They will tell the workmen, plan it in such a way, production should be normal, productivity should be normal, but create a hell for officers inside. In fact, the whole objective is a mass misconduct. Suppose 100 people rush into a manager's cabin. You cannot charge it all the 100 or discipline, take disciplinary action against all the 100. What is the remedy? Lockout is the remedy. A mass misconduct leads to lockout. Now, if you cannot lock out, what is it you can do? Say, for example, a factory having 5,000 workmen. Today, we have lifted lockout in one of the car manufacturing company in Karnataka. 6,500 people work there. If the same agitation had taken place after the court came, what do we do with them? Today, we were able to suspend 39 people. Fine. Can I suspend 6,500 people? So these are the things which they should have thought, unfortunately, are not there. And therefore, all that I can tell you about Industrial Disputes Act is a very, very limited change that has come about. And that change has come about in the form of amendment to strikes and lockouts, definition of industry being amended, Chapter 5B being made applicable to the industrial establishment employing less than 300 workmen. Some small changes are there here and there, which I am not taking you deeply because in the 45 minutes, I give you a broad outline or a guideline of what changes have come. Now, for example, they have done away with labor courts. Now they say industrial tribunal. They say 2 judges in the industrial tribunal. With 1 judge in the industrial tribunal, It used to take 5 years for disposal of a case. With the two judges, imagine how long it will take. We don't need number of judges in the bench. We need people who can deliver goods. You will be shocked. Who are these labor court judges? Most of them are above 50, 55. Civil judges, posted as labor court judges. By the time they understand labor law, they are transferred. Taught at least not less than 200, 300 district judges who became labor court judges in my last 47 years. Ultimately, teach them labor law. By the time they can deliver the goods, they are transferred. A judicial cadre must be developed for appointment of judges to the industrial tribunals. Appointing an IAS officer or a KAS officer along with a district judge, calling it as a bench, expecting relief, is foolhardy. When you talk of specialized tribunals, should you not have a specialized cadre for recruitment to manage those tribunals? Can a person who is a judge at the age of 55 come and start learning labor law? What are we doing? Now, these are areas, unfortunately, which are not. And other, no other changes what the name has been brought into the entire scheme of things. Now, standing orders. Standing orders, I think, made very positive amendments for which I commend the government. One thing made applicable now to 300 or more workmen. So in small industries, small factories, to manage theirs and to have their own service rules and regulations. To that extent, it is a great relief for MSMEs in the country, because they can't be engaging big lawyers and consulting lakhs of rupees and managing IR situation. To that extent, they have been given relief. Is a very, very welcome step. The other good thing about the entire standing orders is, in fact, throughout in all the courts, one of the good feature in the amendment is that time limit is fixed, beyond which it is said it is a deemed permission, deemed license. They have now said you submit your standing orders, prepare it yourself in line with the model standing orders, submit to the officer, the authority, the officer who is supposed to certify, and is supposed to hear and certify within 2 months. Even amendments should be decided within 2 months. At the end of 2 months, if it does not do anything, there's a deemed sanction or a deemed certification. Auto certification, like this thing will come to you, letter will come to you. Now that's wonderful, because I know in one or two companies I have filed writ petitions after 7 years after filing the draft certification, only because the officer wanted a certain amount which the company was not prepared to pay. So every time the case came, they said, "Ye to bekar hai, baju mein dalo." This has been the attitude. I had to go to law and tell the judges, "See, this is exactly what's happening in our state." They had to pass an order saying they'll give only 6 weeks to the gentleman to certify the draft standing he had submitted. Do we expect everybody to go to High Court? So to that extent, this is a wonderful change that the government has brought about, to say that within 2 months, you must finish it. You can't keep beyond 2 months. If you keep beyond 2 months, well, if there's a deemed certification, there's nothing else for you to do. Apart from this process, not much of a change has been made in the standing order side. It remains the same thing. One great improvement is, long back the Supreme Court said in some Lakeri Cements case that you can make standing orders only in respect of matters covered under the schedule to the Act. For example, retirement, transfer, disciplinary action, whatever they are, those must be then the schedule to the Act. Only in respect of those matters you can make a standing order. Here, a small change I have noticed, to say, and other matters. That means scope of the standing orders or inclusion of terms and service conditions in the standing orders appear to have substantially enlarged. Thereby, you can make a comprehensive standing orders also. The hands of the certifying officers are not tied. To that extent, they are given quite a good relief. In the sense, they say, all right, important matters, if it is there, let's let it be there. Let us do it. In Standing Orders Act, everything is fine. But when you come to Trade Union Act, that is the third enactment, Mr. Vikas, you can stop me whenever you think my time is over, so that there's enough time for discussions. Now, trade union, first time in the country, a concept of recognition of trade.
Pardon? So for a minute, I'm just taking, as you feel that wherever the broader contours of the entire code could be explained, it's fine with us. Not take question answers, but if you are able to explain it in a much, much better time with us.
Speed up.
Yeah.
Okay. Trade union, as I was telling you, there's been a lot of debate from a long time in the country as to why there is nothing called compulsory recognition of trade unions, except in Maharashtra. I think somewhere I read somewhere in UP. Beyond that, in other states, there is no recognition of trade union as a compulsory legal obligation. Now they say for the first time, it is obligatory, part of an employer, to recognize trade unions. And what has been done is, if a trade union has 51% of the total number of employees, then that will be called as a recognized trade union. That is called a negotiating council. So for all requirements of the employees, the negotiating council, which has the support of 51% of the total employees in the roles, will do the discussions, negotiation. If it is not possible, then they will make it as a sort of a slightly change it and make it as a group of it or negotiating council constituted of more number, 20%, whoever has got 20% of the total, 20% of the total employees as its member will get one seat. So if a trade union has got 42%, it will get 2 seats. If it has got 60%, it will get 3 seats. And they will form a sort of a council like that. It's like a committee. Now, this has been enforced in some places. But what has bothered me a little, though this is an excellent provision, because I have seen large number of industrial establishments, at least as I know of, in Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, fighting over the issue of recognition and fighting to such an extent that a few of the extremely fine industrial establishment closed down. Personally, I know of BPL, which had 12 factories in Bangalore. The only issue was recognition of the trade union. Management did not want CITU. CITU said, nothing doing, you have to talk to us. It led to a lot of agitation. Finally, only on that issue we had to shut down. Well, in fact, I have been trying my best in the last more than 4 decades to tell employers that you must recognize the union. You can't talk to 300 workmen or 400 workmen or 500 workmen. Each fellow will have his own view. So recognition is required. I can tell you a small example of why recognition is required. In one of my clients, we were giving 11 holidays, national festival holidays. In a settlement, the union bargained for 2 more holidays. And the union told the management, we will decide those 2 holidays. the management said, look here, I say, we have been doing it all these years, we do it, what's your problem? Nothing doing, we have to decide. It's our decision, you should accept our decision. Fine. The management said, all right. Unfortunately, by then, management had put up a list of 13 holidays on the notice board. The workmen stopped work, numbering to more than 1,000, and said to the union, you should remove that notice. The IR manager called me up. Sir, what to do? I said, sir, what is this? You are asking me to remove the notice which I put up. What is an insult to the management? I said, it's not an insult. In industrial relations, don't be oversensitive. It's not an insult. Be proud. You listen to me. Said, sir, what else to do? You are the legal advisor. I have to listen to you. And finally, he went and withdrew the notice. Then we wrote to the union. This is exactly what has happened. Please tell us which are the two additional days you want. They called for a general body meeting. In the general body meeting of 1,000 workmen, 68 holidays were proposed by different groups. Somebody said, I sent this. Somebody said, somebody else said this. And these groups were formed to such an extent. You won't believe, ultimately, the president was so fed up. He told them, no, you are unfit to decide to it. I will write to the management that they can decide to extort. They wrote a letter. Then I told the IR manager, the notice that which you had removed, put up the same notice with the same date on. Then he says, sir, my honor, I am vindicated, sir. My honor is now. I am happy about it. Why I gave this example was, if you don't have recognized unions, so many things happen. Recognition is the best form of for the good industrial relation. I do not know why some of the employers even today feel, no, you're recognizing a union, getting the union is a very difficult thing. We should do without union, and union should not be there, etc., etc. But I don't think to that extent the managements are right in saying they do not want a union. Now, what are the areas which the government has given up, which they should have done? First, to my mind, Industrial Disputes Act 1947 is one of the best legislations in labor laws that I have seen. There's absolutely no need for the government to tamper with it. I have an injury in leg, no doubt. Am I to cut my leg to treat the injury? Or treat the injury and retain my leg? What a small change in 9 years. Look at today's scenario. You want to change the working hours by some little here and there. You want to change the leave provision a little here and there. You want to change the shift timings a little here and there. For everything, 21 days notice. If I'm playing coffee at the workplace and tell them, look, there is some difficulty wherever the coffee center is there, change of workplace, change of service condition. For everything, there is a change of condition. How do you run it? 9 years is so draconian that for every small thing which is absolutely necessary to run establishment, I must give 21 days notice. If I give 21 days notice, the union goes to the conciliation. During the pendency of conciliation, I cannot change without government permission. From there, it goes to adjudication. I cannot change. Adjudication process is complete. So when do I change? What do I do? By then, the necessity. So one of the biggest difficulties the employers faced in the country in the last 70 years has been this notice of change. Flimsy. I can understand notice of change for bringing down the number of holidays, for bringing down wages, for bringing down bonus, but not for, instead of saying Monday, Sunday is the weekly rest day, I say because of some issue, I want a weekly holiday to be changed to so-and-so date. Where is 9 year notice? If I give 9 year notice, by that I cannot make a change at all. Now this has to go, because if this is there, there is no end to it. But what did the government do? They have not touched 9A. Number one. I expected a second change in Section 33 of the Industrial Disputes Act. This protected workman has become a den for all unruly elements in the factory. What is this protected workman? You are elected as an office bearer of the union. You want to ensure that you can behave the way you want. So you get elected as president, vice president, secretary, joint secretary, committee members, so on, so forth. And 1% of the total strength, minimum of 5, maximum of 100, you are entitled to the status of protected workman, which means that if there is a dispute pending anywhere with regard to, normally disputes in larger factories are always pending. You can't take any action against him without taking the permission of the court. How long does it take in Indian courts to grant a permission to dismiss a workman? Minimum 10 years. And for his entire 10 years, you keep paying wages. You are bound to pay wages for 10 years because until you get permission, you cannot terminate him. You cannot retain him inside because he's a very unruly fellow. So therefore, we wanted changes in those areas. Section 9A, we wanted changes in 5B. Why do you want 5B? Nobody sets up a big plant to close. There is no one who has intention to close down at the time of starting. Everybody wants to make money, employ people, give jobs, produce, make a name, make a brand. Unfortunately, everyone will not succeed. So a time comes when you have to decide whether you have to run or not, but government will tell you, no, you will not close. That entire 5B is so draconian that it has to go. And then come to 11A is another provision. Many of them come and ask me, sir, my employee is coming late by half an hour, at least 3 times in a week. Habitual late attendant. I want to take action and dismiss him. You are an expert. Tell me whether I can dismiss him. I've told them only one thing. Best thing for you is to go to an astrologer and ask him whether you can dismiss him. Because in my opinion, what happens? There is so much of indiscipline amongst the judicial officers also. There are a number of officers who come late to the court. If it goes before such a gentleman, he will say, as a district judge, I come 10, 15, 20 minutes late. And why poor workmen, if you go a little late, what happens? Nothing will happen. So you can't dismiss. 11A comes into picture. That is a provision where court can interfere with the quantum of punishment. On the other hand, if it goes before a very sincere, honest judge, he will say yes. If by my coming late, courts will start late. But by this fellow not going, machines will not run. Productivity will suffer. Production will suffer. That means the whole system of punishing for misconduct has become a highly, it is more an objective issue where courts will interfere in the quantum of punishment. I'm not saying courts should not interfere, but somewhere a line must be drawn in what cases they can intervene. Not in all cases. There were Supreme Court judgments. It was one of the Supreme Court judgments in Hombe Gowda Educational Institutions versus the state in Karnataka. The Supreme Court said, we in the Supreme Court are to some extent or to a great extent responsible for indiscipline in the industry. If it were to be tough, if discipline had been given the right due place, we would have been much better. I told this in a division bench with our chief chair. You know, you'll be doing contempt of court. I said, I'll give you the names of judges who passed this order for contempt of court. So what I'm saying is, if outsiders, judicial officers start interfering in the quantum of punishment at every stage, it is impossible. Till now, they used to say, abusing is, they must make abusing nothing, no, after all, he abuses. Till Justice Santosh Hegde came and took a stand very clearly, abusing is a serious misconduct for which punishment of dismissal. In the presence of 500 workmen, a manager is abused in the filthiest words, intolerable words. And then the court says, he only abused, nothing very serious. You could have just warned him. So the manager has no question of self-respect, honor, nothing. It is in this context that we expected the government, the parliament, to think why country's productivity is suffering, why we are not able to produce, why by the fall of a hat the workmen strike work. Go slow is that. Some effort is made to tackle go slow in the new court. Okay, to that extent, I appreciate that change that has been made. Otherwise, as this coalition's code is concerned, much more could have been done. While I'm not condemning the government, while I'm not saying crucial areas are still missing, the problems that are plaguing us will continue to plague us. We will still suffer. Flexibility will still suffer. And we are into trouble. For example, I had been to two solicitors from United States came to Bangalore. Normally in United States, they send a solicitor to find out the environment, the law and other things before they set up a plant. They said, Mr. Murthy advised a number of multinationals from America, so go to him. Somebody known to them, gave the address. They called me to hotel Windsor Manor and said, we want to have dinner with you. I went, normally I don't go there at all, but I went. They said, Mr. Murthy, sorry to bring you to the house. Only one question for you. Do you have a law or will your industrial law permit termination for inefficiency? They want an answer before they recommend putting up money, putting up industry, setting up industry in Karnataka. They want to know, do you have a law which permits us to take action, terminate for inefficiency? I was wondering for myself, if inefficiency is a ground, will there be any number of people left in the government service, even in political areas? Inefficiency is the first thing, efficiency is the last thing. Now, if I tell them, no, you cannot take action for inefficiency, they'll quietly get me the dinner and then say, goodbye, thank you. And if I, so I can't tell them like, therefore, I had only one choice. I said, look, we don't call it inefficiency in this country. We call it neglect of work. We tell them, when others can do in so many hours, why you cannot do? You have neglected work. It is through that process we try to take disciplinary action, terminate them. Some satisfaction, because I don't want them to go with an impression that I'm giving them any wrong ideas or that there is no relief at all. There is some relief, but so this is all I thought I would speak to you on this industrial relations code. I've taken my time. Now it's for Mr. Vikas to take over and proceed. Thank you. Thank you all for a patient hearing.
Thank you, sir. So since you have given the comparative studies of the industrial relations code coupled with the what were the challenges in the Industrial Dispute Act, Trade Union Act and the Industrial Employment Standing Orders. Like we see that whether there has been any change in the Industrial Relations Code and the Standing Order, like initially it used to be, what would be the trade union? Who will be considered as to be the main trade union under the new act, according to you?
Pardon?
Trade union representation.
Whether yes, yes.
51% and 75%, yes, what would yes, be, yes. Who would be the considered as the...
Yes.
In this aspect. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Sorry. Sorry, I got myself muted. I'm just checking as to whether. So, according to you, what would be the broader difference and what is the change of dynamics from, like, originally the industrial tribunal in this industrial establishment used to have? So is it audible? Is it audible?
Please repeat.
Yes, sir. So I was asking, like, in the Industrial Disputes Act and the Industrial Code, like, let's assume what are the new changes if one wants to retrench a workman?
What would be the?
What are the new changes in for the? Let's assume somebody is wanting to be laid off or retrenched.
The rule is the same which was there earlier, except that as on date, if you want to lay off, retrench or close down, you have to take permission of the government if you engage 100 or more workmen. Once a code comes into operation, instead of 100, it will be 300, less than 300 workmen. You can close down or retrench or lay off without going to government. 300 or more will go to government as it is even today, seeking permission to lay off, retrench or close.
Okay. And what are the new changes for a strike part under the Trade Union Act?
The strike is what I say, 14 days notice. He is going to ruin the industry. How can I give 14 days of notice of lockout? I don't understand the government's thinking. Supposing there is something going on very seriously inside. Impossible. Officers are being put in a room and cajoled. No strike. An officer is beaten. No strike. I am to lock out. How to lock out? How do I give 14 days notice? I need an immediate relief. That is, immediately I want all the workmen to get out of the factory so that violence doesn't spread. But I am told you must give 14 days notice. This is a highly retrograde step. There are situations. They must have some exceptions. In case of violence, management may lock out even without giving notice. Next question will be, supposing the management misuse. There is a court which will look into it. What was the violence? Who was hurt? Whether it happened? Whether it comes under that exception? Whether what they have done is right or wrong? All this can be gone into. But can you blanket say nothing doing?
And so what are the challenges? Like, now we have that fixed term employment protection.
Fixed term employment is a big fraud on the employers of this country, Mr. Vikas, because I have written several articles on this in the last five, six years. What is fixed term employment? Employing for a given period, say 2 years or 3 years. You are employed for 3 years, it's called fixed term employment. At the end of 3 years, it automatically ceases. What if I start a factory today with 200 workmen and appoint everyone for 2 years? At the end of 2 years, I send them home. At half the salary, I bring another 200 people. I keep them for another 2 years and send them. What happens to security of service? What is all this labor law about? What is all this service law about? Therefore, this fixed term employment is a fraud, I say repeatedly, because if you read the existing section 200BB, 200BB was introduced into the definition of retrenchment to say that a workman employed under a contract of employment for a fixed period, and when his fixed period comes to an end, the employment automatically comes to an end. It was an exception to retrenchment. You need not go to the government for permission. Now, that was already there. The courts interpreted that, including Supreme Court. What did the court say? Look here, I say you have a man for 3 years. He has learned the job. Now he has to keep on increasing his salary. You quietly ask him to go, saying, I have appointed you on a fixed term for 3 years, and bring another man to the same place. Where is security of employment? What happens to Section 25H? 25H of the Industrial Disputes Act says, when you retrench a workman, fine. But when you want to increase your strength, you must call the retrenched workman first. All that law which is still in the statute book, which will continue to be in the statute book even under the code, are given a go-by in this fixed-term employment. There is nothing like fixed-term employment. This is fraud. Straight fraud, because you are telling the employer, employ for fixed term and throw them out. No, courts will not allow that. The government must know what the courts have said on fixed term employment. Courts have categorically told us, look here, gentlemen, only work which by itself gets exhausted in a given time is allowed for fixed term employment. For example, I have brought 100 new machines. I want to do time study of these machines. I need three engineers. Three engineers need to work for 2 years to make time study. So those three engineers carry out a time study for 2 years. At the end of 2 years, time study is over, job is over, they will go. That is fixed term employment. I can't say CNC machine which is being operated today will be operated by somebody else tomorrow because this period is over. Then why have all these books, all this industrial law, all the volumes of industrial law written by judges for last 70 years, it's all waste. Justice Krishna has said, any workman who works for 2 days in a period of 12 months swims into the harbor of... So this is not working. This won't work.
So the last question I will take is that I have also experienced while practicing, at least in some parts of the private sectors, I have seen that people tend to join tend to join some other company, and thereafter they also claim to the effect that the employer wants to show that there is an abandonment, and ultimately he says that I have been retrenched, and he orders is reinstatement. I have seen few of the cases from Panipat I had, wherein I had seen that he had in fact joined some other company, though it couldn't be proved. But he said that he has wrongly been retrenched and he claimed his reinstatement, whereas it was a case of abandonment. Do you feel that this has been plugged in the new code or no?
No, there is nothing in the new code. There is nothing in the new code. What I want to say is when he joins...
Because invariably... employment of abandonment, whereas he takes the stand of retrenchment.
Abandonment is a different concept altogether. Supreme Court says abandonment should be accompanied by intention to give up. Intention to give up. I don't want to say I am working with a certain company X now. After 10 days, without telling you, I go and join your competitor. Abandon you straight away. But you cannot say if I don't come for 10 days, I'm abandoned employment. You will have to demonstrate to the court, look here, this gentleman, this fellow who was working with me, went and joined so-and-so company. And that is very the unique number under the Provident Fund Act. Whichever company he goes, from going into his account number, he's working. This is precisely what we are doing. Because a good workman to get a good salary must join a good company. He will not join some useless company when he has worked in good company. He will try to find out a better company, and all of them are covered. And tell the judge, look, he left me. He left another company. Now, where's the question of reinstatement? Does it arise?
Do you feel that there should be some linkage of the workman as such to the fact that let's assume his credentials are codified just like a fingerprint, so that let's assume he's drawing salary from somewhere else. So that lacuna can be plugged in that he's working somewhere else. There can be identification in some manner of salary, etc. Because these workmen sometimes...
Many times. In fact, more than 60-70% of the workmen who approach the court, they go there not to get back work from you, get back to your factory. They go there to get some monetary compensation while they will be working in some other place. Now, difficulty
is... Wherever there is an industrial hub.
Yes. The difficulty
is... I'm saying wherever there is an industrial hub, this problem does arise.
wherever there is
an industrial hub, people do shift from one company to the another.
Correct.
And then they say that, we say that it's an abandonment. The employees are sometimes taking legal advices from people like you, and they ultimately suffer.
There's a very, you know, today, I may share with you now that you said this. I, more than industry contact me directly, advocates contact, after messing up the whole thing, they telephone to the, they tell their client, there's a lawyer in Jayanagar, well known in labor law circle. You take this file and go to him. So when he brings the file, I know it has been totally ruined. And only to get rid of that man from his cabin, he sends me to my cabin. This good advice, what you're talking about, is very, 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 very crucial issue, which industry must, at high time, the industry must realize. If there's no point in appointing a retired labor officer as your husband, because he will do it for 1,000 or 2,000 rupees per month. The problem is, if you want to talk to Murthy, you must take an appointment, go sit there, talk to him, discuss with him, pay his fees, which invariably an advocate for almost 18, 19 years. So he will charge more. And some of them, some of the consultants deliberately spread the information in Karnataka that S.N. Murthy charges very high so that they may not come also. So all these things, you know, employer must decide. Whereas in finance, the employers take the best man. They don't do that for IR. Good advice is required. You're right, 100% right. Because I have said, in industrial law, the entire atmosphere, the position of law, the statutes, rules, are all with labor, and including the judge. So that means you must be 100% legal. You must make it impossible for the judge to pass an order against you, because even if he gets the slightest opportunity, he will pass order against the employer. That is the trend. From the beginning, that is the trend.
One question was, what would be the distinction? I will ask, because somehow the net had failed. One had asked the question, what would be the subtle difference between a contractual employee and a workman as such?
Contract employee and contract workman.
Yes.
That is appointed through a contractor. Contract
one
labor.
Question, yes, one had asked, since you have not touched the issue of through appointment through contractor, now I will be taking this last question. We have largely seen that even in the governmental organization, now the employment has been outsourced through a contractor.
Correct.
So do you feel that the doctrine of lifting of veil can be applied in such cases to say therein that the government is the principal employer, and therefore the employer who has been employed through a contractor under this act of 1971, by applying the doctrine of veil, we can say that the government is the principal employer, therefore his services for all intents and purposes should be controlled by the government itself, and he could not be replaced by another person? Because this type of litigation of late has started off, wherein we find that the government takes the stand that they have outsourced to a, they have given the entire contractual employment to a contractor, and contractor, he keeps on changing the employees. So you feel that he will have the protection because doctrine of veil way back in 2002 in HSEB versus Suresh Kumar, the law came into being wherein they said that you can lift the veil and then see who is the principal employer or whether he has taken the exemption under Section 10 of the Act.
Yes, this is Section 10 of the Act has been forgotten by the governments. Rarely they use Section 10. With the result, the objective of having Section 10 in the Act is defeated, number one. Two, In steel authority case, Constitution bench clearly said two things. One is the contract must be a genuine contract. It should not be a sham contract. What is a sham contract, they said? Lift the veil. Lift the veil. Lift the veil is a sham contract. This is precisely what Supreme Court said in steel authority, five judges sitting there said. But what I am saying is, look at the court today. I'm not on, I think contract level is not covered here, but I'll answer that question. I think I'll take that in the next, but I'll answer this question. There has been a lot of fight between the unions and the management with regard to contract labor. To my mind, contract labor is a way of exploiting labor. And permanent workmen are very happy if they are a contract workman because they work less and allow the contract labor to work more. Government finds this convenient because they are given away Bombay Airport, they are given away Chennai Airport, they are given away Bangalore Airport, all to the private people. They want to wash off their hands. It would have been a very nice thing if the government had taken, gone into it at the depth and made certain improvements in that field. But on the other hand, it's a very sorry state of affairs that in the recent amendment, the code, they have taken a retrograde step. What they have said now is, contractor means they have divided into two portions. Contractor means a person who agrees to produce a given result for an establishment, number one. Number two, contractor means a person who merely supplies labor. The word merely. Earlier, merely was not there. So Supreme Court in Haryana State Electricity Board said nothing doing. It's a sham contract. You put all of them on your roads, 1,100 linemen of Haryana State. Now, the government is, just to satisfy their requirement, have come with an amendment of the definition of contractor, where a person who merely provides labor is also a contractor. So don't ask about sham now. No lifting of veil. No sham contract. Steel authority judgments thrown to the winds. Now if they, I can sit in my room. I've got 5,000 people with me. Mr. Vikas says, send me 1,000 people. I send 1,000 people. What Mr. Vikas does with it is his position. I simply send them nothing. No supervision, no control. I'll tell them, go and report it so-and-so to Mr. So-and-so. I get my money. They have made it easy to employ contract labor. On the other hand, they should have made it tougher. But it's the other way around. Only precaution they have taken is, they have defined what is known as non-core objects now for the first time. When Mr. Chandrababu Naidu was the Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh, they had done it long back, way back. Now Government of India has woken up. They don't say what is core activity. They say which are the non-core activities. They have listed it. And they said, in those activities, you can engage contract labor. That means in core activities, you will give credit to the government to have thought of it, at least to that extent. Now, rest we'll have to see, how, because when money speaks, grammar does not matter in this country. So officers will interpret the way you want. It's only a question of how much you can part with. So you have to wait.
Before parting for the day, like you said, that the money makes the interpretation the way it is. In the law, there's another wording. They say that a lawyer reads what is written in law. And a good lawyer is one like you who makes the court read the manner in which you want to read.
Yeah, but then even then, many a time, judges, poor fellows, I understand their anxiety. They can't deviate from the written words. They try to interpret, they try to somehow see that a good, correct meaning is given. But with all that, they are still finding it difficult when the wordings are so clear as what they have done. Now with the change in the definition of contractor, I'm afraid contract label will be more and more deployed. But there are restrictions. If it is implemented in good spirits, without looking into other requirements and things, core activities, you can avoid contract labor. That means something is done. Now, if you look at, for example, Airports Authority of India. Airports Authority of India is supposed to maintain airports, establish and maintain airports. Now, the core activity is to establish airports and maintain airports. How can you give that work on contract to somebody else tomorrow once the court comes? The trouble starts from there. Somebody was telling me about four or five years. Sir, your time was the best time in 70s when you came. A lot of labor problems. You did your master's degree, made a name, made money, made fortune, everything. What about us? There are no problems at all. I said, don't worry. As long as the government of India is what is, you will have problems. I can assure my youngsters in the profession, next 40 to 50 years, they will have enough and more of litigation.
Right, sir. I'm just reminded, as of like you said, a lot of lawyers and a lot of people speak about you to the effect that you did your best. So I'm just, on the parting shot, we will say that they say where there is a law, there is a flaw, and where there is a flaw, there has to be a lawyer, and where there is a lawyer, then it has to be S. M. Murthy. And so tomorrow's session, we take a step further, OPM, disciplinary proceedings with special reference to pensionary matters thereafter. P.S. Rajagopal, senior advocate from Karnataka. So do stay connected with us tomorrow. And to all those participants who have been watching us live on the Facebook as well as on this platform, we are thankful to Trivikram, who introduced us to Mr. S. N. Murthy. And to all those participants, stay safe, stay blessed, and take the things forward after taking the insights from what Mr. S. N. Murthy said, that he has shown the insights of the topic, and you can take the things forward. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe. Jai Hind.
Thank you. Thank you.
Namaskar.
Thank you.
Right, sir.